these two openly gay co-chairmen of the Judiciary Committee. After that court ruling came down, it was payback time. They wanted revenge against the church. They tried, at the end of the decade in 2009, they tried to pass a bill that would have stripped Catholic bishops and priests of financial authority over their own parishes in Connecticut.
And I remember that.
Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. And we were able to close that down and then use the momentum from that to secure the religious liberty exemptions that we had been pursuing before Lawler and McDonald tried to do that. Religious liberty, we've stopped assisted suicide every year for a decade since 2013. We not just stopped it, but crushed it. They couldn't even get it out of committee. We may be in more trouble this year because they're exploiting the coronavirus.
Right, the fears around that.
Joyful, joyful, Lord, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of
life. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to this edition of the Dr. J Show. My guest today is Peter Wolfgang, who's the executive director of the Family Institute of Connecticut, and in my mind, one of the more effective state policy center guys out there. So, Peter Wolfgang, I'm very happy to have you on board. How are you doing today?
I'm good, Jennifer. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm really grateful that you could make the time to join me on this. You know, the Ruth Institute is a interfaith international coalition to defend the family and build a civilization of love. We don't do legislatures, you know, we don't go in and lobby and all that kind of thing, but it's part of our area of concern is what guys like you do. And so I thought our followers and listeners and viewers would be interested in hearing what a state policy council does. And I want them to hear from you because I know you're pretty effective at it. So why don't you tell people a little bit about the Family Institute and what your mission is and how you accomplish it?
Sure. So your viewers have heard you mention state family policy a couple times. And so what they need to know, first of all, is that there are these entities called Family Policy Councils, FPC for short. Family Policy Councils exist in about 40 of the 50 states. We are in the one I run, Family Institute of Connecticut. We are the FPC, the Family Council, Family Policy Council for the state of Connecticut. We were all loosely affiliated with Focus on the Family, which is an evangelical Protestant organization out of Colorado. The proper legal term is associated. We're not legally affiliated with them, but there's this loose association where we all network together. We all meet together. We all share resources together. I mean, we're all responsible. We're all autonomous. We're all responsible for raising our own funds and so forth. But we are part of the, I mean, we're basically the de facto local chapter in the state of Connecticut for Focus on the Family. And for any of your listeners who may not be familiar with Focus on the Family, it's something that I think really dovetails with the work that you do, Dr. J, and the Ruth Institute. Focus on the Family was founded in the 1970s by Dr. Jason, who was a child psychologist, as well as a Church of the Nazarene minister. And, you know, Dr. Dobson, he had a real heart for children and for family and for the decline in marriage and family life in America already by the 1970s. That concerned him greatly.
Yes.
You know, the age of Aquarius had hit in the late 60s. It had been the era of free love and all that. And already by the 1970s, in the early 70s, we had the no-fault divorce revolution, which it was sold to us as this liberalizing reform that was going to make everyone happier. You know, mommy and daddy won't fight anymore. The kids are resilient. They'll bounce back. Children and adults, everyone will be happy. And Dr. Dobson was one of the early prophets to recognize how wrong this was and how mm-hmm. it was a disaster for family and for the nation. So he was an early pioneer in the pro-family movement. He started Focus on the Family in, I think, 1976, I want to say. And by the late 1980s, it became obvious that a lot of these battles, and when you're talking about marriage, when you're talking about a crisis in marriage, in the 70s and 80s. At that point, you're talking about divorce. Of course, it metastasized and other things popped up, and we'll get into that. But already by the late 1980s, it became obvious to focus on the family that a lot of these battles were going to be won or lost at the state level in state capitals. And so what Focus on the Family did was they encouraged the development of these FPCs, of these family policy councils. The one in Connecticut, Family Institute of Connecticut, that I am now the director of, excuse me, they were founded in 1989. FIC has been around, the acronym for my organization, FIC has been around for over 30 years, founded in 1989 by a group of evangelical ministers in Windsor, Connecticut. Actually, the same location where the state of Connecticut itself was founded, in that area. And some of those ministers are still around, the Reverend Earl Imsweiler, my good friend, Rich Kendall. I mean, there were a group of, Rich is Eastern Orthodox. I think I should back up and say too, speaking of that, although Focus on the Family is itself an evangelical Christian organization, the FPC, certainly ours in Connecticut, is ecumenical. We're not a creedal organization. We don't require people to subscribe to a particular creed, but we are committed to defending the Judeo-Christian underpinnings of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution of the United States. We fight for a pro-family culture and the rebuilding of a pro-marriage culture in the state of Connecticut. That is what Earl Imsweiler, all that founding generation, my friend Rich Kendall, an Eastern Orthodox layman, that's what they were all trying to do. I would
so that's consistent with the way the Ruth Institute operates. Also, we're not a creedal organization, but everybody who's drawn to us is drawn to the common concern to defend the family in the public square and around the kitchen table too, as we sometimes say, you know, because there are multiple battles that have to be dealt with, and you guys are engaged in that one, and we can certainly lock arms with people across the whatever the denomination or whatever the faith background may be. It's very important that we work together, actually. So anyway, continue, Peter.
I would say that most of our membership tends to be either evangelical, Protestant, or Catholic. We're probably about 50-50.
I see.
It kind of reflects the demographics of the state of Connecticut, but we do have a smattering of Mormons, of Eastern Orthodox, various Black and Hispanic inner city churches, storefront Pentecostal churches. All these folks are in the mix. It is a broad coalition, but I imagine if we were to do a pie chart, I would say we're about 50-50, I'd say, between the evangelicals and the Catholics. They definitely provide most of the heft for what keeps us going.
I see. And so how did you personally get involved in pro-family advocacy, Peter?
So I've always been pro-life. I have not always been a conservative. And the things kind of hang together. For me, I grew up in a suburb of Hartford, Connecticut. I grew up in Manchester, Connecticut. And I had the, I'm a 51-year-old man, so I'm a product of Generation X, child of the 70s, teenager of the 1980s, and I grew up in secular liberal Connecticut with pretty much the values of everyone around me, except on the life issue. My father is Jewish. He's like a lot of Jewish people. He's secular. He's hostile to hostile or indifferent to religion in general, including his own. But so half my family is Jewish, and my mom is Portuguese. She's Catholic. And, back then in the late 60s when they got married, that was fine as long as my dad agreed to that the kids would be raised Catholic. And again, I'd say he was more indifferent than hostile. He didn't really care either way. So he signed off on that. And my two younger brothers and I were brought up Catholic, and I'm Catholic today. But at that time growing up, what that meant was we were essentially Christmas and Easter Catholics. I'd say for about the first 16 years of my life or so, even though my mom was at the time kind of a nominal Catholic, my grandmother, her mother, was definitely a very strong Catholic, very strong old school Portuguese Catholic. raised me with a very strong devotion to Our Lady of Fatima.
Bingo. Hold on. Hold it right there, Peter. For our non-Catholic viewers, I knew he was going to end up there. When he said his grandma was Portuguese, I'm like, Fatima. So these apparitions in Fatima took place in 1917, and they've turned out to be a very important, you could say, cultural influence within this within the Catholic Church ever since then. So even though no doctrine has changed, nothing like that has changed, as a cultural phenomenon, Fatima is very important. So Peter, tell your story about this, because I think it'll give people a feel. I just know where this is going to go. So go ahead, Peter.
And there's a couple of, you know, looking back, you kind of like, oh my gosh, where is God leading me? What's going on in my life? And then you look back and you can see all the influences and how it all came together. And so Fatima, especially, I think, for some of the challenges that we face now in 2021, I think Fatima is big again. But just to back up and underline what you said, for any non-Catholic viewers who are wondering what's this all about, the Catholic Church makes a distinction between public revelation and private revelation. Public revelation is basically the Bible, right? It ends with public revelation ends with the death of the last apostle, with Saint John the Apostle, with the book of Revelation. Public revelation is something that we are all required to believe in. You know, as a Christian, you should believe in public revelation and in God's revelation to us in Scripture. Private revelation is something different. Most people, even if you're not Catholic, you may have heard of Our Lady of Fatima, Our Lady of Lourdes, Our Lady of Guadalupe. And there are these apparitions that have happened in history. And what the church does is they investigate these things, and sometimes they sign off on them and sometimes they don't. Sometimes they'll condemn them or say this isn't authentic. Even when the church says you can believe in this, we find nothing here that contradicts Scripture or public revelation. That's all they're saying. All they're saying is you can believe in this if you want to. There's nothing contradictory here. You don't have to believe in it.
Right.
So that private revelation is something lesser than public revelation. Nonetheless, for me personally, for my story, I have to say, Our Lady of Fatima, it's weird. Like, looking back, I can see how God was shipping me to be the head of an ecumenical organization. My dad was Jewish. I was Catholic, but a non-practicing Catholic. And then the other thing, besides Fatima, I'll come back to Fatima in a moment, but the other weird thing in the mix for a kid who was half Catholic and half Jewish was my parents sent me to a Church of the Nazarene Sunday school when I was a child. And so that's in the mix too. You heard me mention how Dr. Dobson was a Church of the Nazarene minister. So I almost wonder if there was some sort of affinity there. But in the late 1970s, I went there from about the age of 5 to 9 or 10 years old. They had a van that would come pick you up every morning, my brother and me, on Sunday mornings. So my parents didn't even have to get out of bed. They got us out of the house. And they did it. That's the only reason they did it.
Right. The Church of the Minimum Transit Time is what we call that in economics.
It had the effect, I'm the only, and really at the same time I was going to Church of the Nazarene Sunday School on Sunday morning, I was still going to CCD on like Tuesday or Wednesday afternoon, making my first communion. I always understood myself to be Catholic and nothing else. I understood that I was going to something that was a little different on Sunday morning. Nevertheless, the great value, looking back on it, of Church of the Nazarene was that it exposed me to the King James Bible. And that, like the echoes, the resonances, the cadences of the King James Bible, I think has always planted deep seeds in me. So I've got this weird combination of the King James Bible and Our Lady of Fatima, even though I was a nominal, mostly non-practicing Catholic as a child. My grandmother's love of Our Lady of Fatima and my exposure to the King James Bible and that soaring language we were taught as children to memorize Psalm 23, you know, all that beautiful Elizabethan English, right. You know, it really spoke, I thought, to God's transcendence. And Our Lady of Fatima was very important. Our Lady of Fatima was an apparition of the Mother of God in 1917 in Portugal. And of course, as I said, I'm Portuguese, to three illiterate shepherd children who knew nothing about the things she told them about. She warned of, she said World War I would come to an end, but that if people didn't repent, there'd be a second world war. She warned against communism. Now, this began in May of 1917 and continued monthly to October 1917, which of course was the month of the October Revolution in Russia. And these kids had no idea what communism was, but she told them that communism, war, all these things were a punishment for our sins, that unless mankind repented, you know, these things would be allowed to happen, that the church would be persecuted by communism. She laid down a peace plan from heaven. We should pray the rosary daily. We should make what are called the five first Saturdays, go to mass the first Saturday of every month, 5 months in a row, go to confession, and that eventually that she would triumph, her Immaculate Heart would triumph, and there would be a period of peace in the world. And one thing, if you're our age, one thing that gave you comfort that you were not following a cult was in 1981 when Pope John Paul II was shot.
Yep.
On the anniversary of Our Lady of Fatima, he put two and two together. He developed a great open public devotion to Our Lady of Fatima. So having this great Pope on your side, I think mattered too. And then in 91, the Soviet Union comes down and it felt like a lot of the prophecies of Fatima came true. Now, why is that still interesting in 2021? What does that have to do with the Ruth Institute and the Family Institute of Connecticut? I would argue everything. Because we are now 30 years out from the Soviet Union. And while it is true that the Soviet Union is gone, what you and I together are fighting, it goes under a lot of different names and titles. One of them is cultural Marxism. And I think at the end of the day, what you and I are up against, I think what we had in 91 was actually kind of a partial victory. We did.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. We were so excited. Okay. Yeah. So for the young people who didn't, for whom this is not a memory, I can remember we were so excited and we thought that because the Berlin Wall had come down, because the Soviet Union was no longer a thing, that everything was going to get better. As an economist, Peter, I can tell you, we thought all you got to do is go over there, establish some property rights, and the whole thing will fall down. You know, maybe give them a banking system, few good regulations and stuff like that. The whole thing will collapse. It'll be great. They'll be just like us. You know, that's what people thought. What's that?
It was the end of history.
That's right. That's right. That's what we all thought. And so what people of our generation had to learn, y'all, is that just because your enemy is wrong doesn't mean you're right.
Yeah.
You know, you're not 100% right. There were a lot of things we didn't see. So even though we were on the right side of the Cold War, and I'm glad communism has gone down, at least to the extent it did, what I didn't predict, and probably you didn't either, is that all of those people who were committed in some way or another to Marxism, who were committed to centralizing society, who were committed to a kind of totalitarianism, the collapse of the economic system didn't slow them down one bit. They just shifted all their energy over to the family.
Yep.
Right. All right. And that has been their new field of operation for the accumulation of power, for the centralization of government and the state. And all of these things that Peter already alluded to, no-fault divorce, we talk about this all the time at the Ruth Institute. I'm sure you know this, Peter, that it looks like it's a big increase in freedom. But in fact, it's the entry point for the state to be ever more involved in ever more detailed aspects of people's lives. Because now you got the family court sitting in the back seat of your van, in effect, watching what the kids are saying to each other, listening in. You know, any child in a divorced family can become an informant on one side or another of a dispute. It's crazy, you know, and we're not here to talk about no-fault divorce particularly, but it is a particular instance of the larger problem of what seems like freedom turning out to be not freedom, turning out to be the vehicle of actual further enslavement, which would not have surprised St. Paul when you think about it. Surprised all of us, but it would not have surprised St. Paul. What do you say, Peter?
Look, and in the mix too, and this is part of the influence I look back on. My own parents divorced when I was a teenager in the 80s.
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. My golly, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So all the things that we're fighting, I mean, my brothers and I are victims of that, of the way the world changed too after the sexual revolution. So So all of that was in the mix. And I was, you know, I, again, as I said, I was actually very typical of my generation in of the locality in the Northeast where I was growing up. Nonetheless, there were these influences that were kicking around inside me. And eventually something sparked. I was always pro-life. But I was politically interested, but I was a young man of the left. My very first vote for president when I turned 18 was for Michael Dukakis. I was at American University in Washington. I was the president of the College Democrats. I hosted a party for Bill and Hillary Clinton when he was first running for president as the president of the College Democrats. So, and I was pro-life back then. I loved, you know, wherever you could find them, the late Bob Casey Sr. in Pennsylvania, Ray Flynn, the mayor of Boston, these rare pro-life Democrats who spoke up about the issue, I identified with them, but I was nonetheless a Democrat. And I think what changed me was, so I graduated college, came back to Connecticut, excuse me. I graduated college, came back to Connecticut, went to UConn Law School in the mid 90s. And this was around the time that the Republicans took over Congress for the first time in 40 years. And even though I had always been a pro-life Democrat, for the first time, because the Republicans had Congress, legislation actually moved through committee and got put on the president's desk. And one of those pieces of legislation was the ban on partial birth abortion, which Bill Clinton vetoed repeatedly throughout the 90s. Now, up until now, Jennifer, my attitude had always been, oh, we Democrats, we're the good, or we liberals, whatever, we're the good, compassionate people who care about the underdog. It's those mean conservatives who only care about the rich and the powerful. We should be pro-life. They should be pro-choice, pro-abortion. All this is just an intellectual error. If I can just explain this to my liberal friends, we'll flip. They'll flip. Daniel Patrick Moynihan, the senator of New York, who never voted our way on any life issue, voted with us on this because he said it was too close to infanticide. And that's what partial birth abortion was.
Right.
And so it was shocking to me that my liberal friends supported even partial birth abortion. It was so shocking to me that I began to read deeply into political philosophy. It all kind of came together in the mid-90s around partial birth abortion. I read my way into the conservative movement. First Things magazine had a big effect on me. And, you know, through those magazines, you read about other authors, you read about books. And at the tail end of that, I came out of it a conservative. I came out of it so focused on that aspect of conservatism, the sort of things you read about in the conservative Catholic magazines, that I wanted to graduate law school and go to work for Family Research Council down in Washington. And what ended up happening, I didn't even know at the time that they have like local chapters around the country, is that I ended up working instead for the Family Institute of Connecticut. And that is kind of a long-winded version of how I ended up at FIC.
Well, it certainly has some interesting twists and turns. But I remember First Things magazine was a very important magazine, I think, for a lot of people, because for me, I was a lapsed Catholic during a lot of that period of time. And when I came back to the faith, it was important to me to see that there was an intellectual power in Catholicism, that it was not a peasant religion, or it was not exclusively a peasant religion. It was a religion that had room for the intellect, and it was a room for your immigrant grandma who couldn't, you know, who was not particularly even literate. You know, it doesn't matter. There's room for everyone. And First Things was a big important part of that, as far as I was concerned. And that's an interesting group of people. I don't want to go too far down that rabbit hole, but one thing that I remember about them was this issue that they had, I want to say in 1996 or 1997, it was called The End of Democracy. And it was their big forum that they had, where they had a lot of different writers write in and talk about judicial tyranny and judicial usurpation of politics. I think that's what they called it. And it was the end of democracy because you couldn't vote on these things anymore. We were being ruled by the robed masters and all of that. And the thing that was striking about it at that time, now only looking back on it, at the time it went right by me, but is how many people found that objectionable? He had board members resign from the board of First Things because they thought he was going theocon. They thought he was becoming, that he was giving up on the Republic, that he was no longer loyal to America. You know, how can you call this a regime, you know? But now looking back on it, they were tame. They were completely tame. You know, Newhouse should have gone farther in a sense that there was already a, you could already see the germ of a regime, a new, there was a, the America of the year 2000 was a different America than the year of America of 1965. And what had changed in there was the sexual revolution and all of the state apparatus that was required to support it and defend it and prop it up. So there were already lawfare. You remember Joe Scheidler, you were talking about Joe Scheidler who died recently. Okay. This is a guy who was one of the early guys who would stand out in front of abortion clinics and pray and be a presence in front of abortion clinics. The National Organization for Women sued him for racketeering, and they used the federal RICO statutes against him. They legally harassed that man for 28 years. Okay, that's the sexual state. That's not just a you know, two private citizens duking it out in the war of ideas on an equal playing field. That's not what that is at all. That was already, and that was well underway when Newhouse and his pals wrote this thing about the end of democracy. That was, you know, that was already a big story in progress. But there are numerous instances of that where the state really has come in on the side, on one side in the culture wars. And that's what you and I deal with every day, right?
Very much so. That specific issue, I was 26 years old when that came out, had a huge impact on me. I was actually in law school at the time, taking a class on jurisprudence. And I, you know, I brought that in, showed it to my professor. We ended up turning the whole semester into like almost a seminar about that issue.
Is that right? Good for you. Good for you that you did that.
There was this population conference, this United Nations population conference in Cairo, Egypt in 94, where the Clinton administration did battle with Pope John Paul II, and the Pope won. He stopped the United States from imposing a universal right to abortion around the world. And, you know, already you saw the beginnings of the things we're dealing with now. If you are a child of the Cold War and you're used to trying to stop Soviet imperialism around the world, and in fact, there were always leftists here in America, you know, the Nation magazine. It's an old tradition of saying, no, it's actually, let's blame America first. It's really America that's imperialist. And you always thought, well, those, they're just a bunch of anti-American nuts. By the 1990s, by the Clinton era, you enter a period where it really is the United States that is now really being culturally imperialist to the entire world when they're trying to impose a right to abortion on the entire world. John Paul II stopped them. And then later on under Obama, and now we'll deal with this again under Biden, it's going to be, they're going to try to force LGBT around the world as well. But things like that, going directly against John Paul II, I think had an effect on me.
That brings us right up to today, that Clinton Catholic strategy of wrapping himself in the mantle of compassion like he's Mother Teresa, as if Mother Teresa was on board with an abortion agenda, okay? But now we have the exact same kind of strategy with the Democrats and the mainstream media talking about how Joe Biden is so Catholic and he's so devout. And it's revolting to me as a Catholic. I find it revolting. He should have been censured a long time ago. By some bishop somewhere, but that's not something you or I can control. It's very frustrating to us, but not something we seem to be able to influence.
Now, under Pope Francis, according to Father D'Souza, the Pope's man in America is Cardinal Supich, and the chief media interpreter of the Francis pontificate is Father James Martin, and that's a very different shift from where the church has been. If that's true, I mean, we're all kind of reading tea leaves, but that is kind of what it looks like.
Yes. And to support that interpretation, Peter, I recently saw that Pope Francis is going to make a video appearance at the Los Angeles Religious Education Congress, which to my mind is a disaster. That Congress has been a dissenting nightmare for a long time. And the Ruth Institute did its part to try to ask Cardinal Mahoney to step aside a couple of years ago when the whole clergy sex abuse thing exploded, because I felt then, and I still feel now, that a man with his record, every time he opens his mouth in public, he's stabbing the hearts of the other victims who are still out there. You know, he really should have the decency to stay home. But of course, he's not staying home. And Pope Francis seems to be endorsing that wing of the Catholic Church. So that makes our job very difficult. I try to navigate this line of saying, you know, what I say as a practicing Catholic is that we stand for the doctrine. We stand for the ancient teachings of the church that come down from the apostles. That's what we're loyal to. We're not loyal to any particular prelate or any particular pope or bishop or anything else. We, you know, we're loyal to the teaching itself. And anybody who's on board with the teaching, I'll talk to them all day long. And if not, if you're not on board with the teaching, I'm going to challenge you. I want to know why not. I want reasons. I want evidence. And that's the thing that drives me batty about the left, whether religious or not, is that they will not confront reasons and evidence.
No.
You notice that? Yeah.
That's why we lost the same-sex marriage fight. We thought, well, if we just have the best arguments, then it's game over. No, apparently not.
Right. And I think, again, for the people who are part of the wider audience, not necessarily following these particular issues so closely, the things that that people are now calling the cancel culture, that was all perfected during gay marriage. And it was ramped up with the abortion issues, you know, the various ways that opponents were silenced rather than confronted with reasons and evidence. That's been going on for a long time. Peter, tell us some of your stories about that.
Well, I often say there's a straight line from same-sex marriage to cancel culture. I think had we stopped same-sex marriage, I don't think we'd be living in cancel culture right now.
Oh, no. Yeah. But so, that's part of how they want it. You know, that's part of how they want it. At some point, I was out there debating on a regular basis. I was going to several law schools, you know, on a monthly basis. I was out and about debating gay marriage on law school campuses. At some point, somebody decided this was no longer a debatable issue.
Yeah.
And that was well before 2015 that came down, you know, just little by little, it was just considered it was not even debatable. So was I canceled? Well, I had protesters a few times. I had that kind of thing happen to me. Nothing like what happened to Charles Murray and Ben Shapiro and some of the others who've had their lives threatened. That never happened to me. But the fact is, you know, you'd go out with a set of arguments and they'd act like they'd never heard it before. Students would come. This was interesting to me, Peter. The students would come up to me and they would say, "You gave me something to think about," you know, because they had never thought about the fact that redefining marriage was going to redefine parenthood, mm-hmm. and that would have all kinds of consequences. They never wanted to talk about anything long term. They always wanted to say, well, they've had gay marriage in Canada for 5 years and nothing bad happened in 5 years, so therefore shut up. You know, it's like, what? You know, you're changing the way the generations relate to each other, and a 5 years is all you want to figure out whether that's a good idea? You know, come on, you guys. So there was always a reluctance to talk very deeply about the long-term consequences. But in that, it goes right back to how no-fault divorce is handled, how abortion's handled, you know, the long-term consequences of legalizing contraception, as you all there in Connecticut were at the center of that, at the center of that thing too, Griswold versus Connecticut. The long-term consequences of these things, nobody ever thinks about that. So when you are in the state legislature, I want to give people a feel for what the daily life of the Family Institute of Connecticut is like. You know, when you're dealing with issues in the same in the state legislature, what would be like your top three issues that you have dealt with historically and that you expect to be dealing with coming up here?
Same-sex marriage has, you know, if we're throwing historically in there, same-sex marriage is a big one. It's really our signature issue. Like I said, we were founded in 1989. And of course, same-sex marriage did not arrive until the early 2000s. But right. I would say we were way below the radar until the 21st century. When the same-sex marriage agenda arrived, we were like the tip of the spear. So we went way above the radar and we became known. And that's when Family Institute of Connecticut regularly became front page news. So historically, that's a big one. We can circle around back to that in a moment. But in terms of the top three, I'd say the other two are assisted suicide and attacks on crisis pregnancy centers. Those two issues are still very live. Regarding same-sex marriage, we continue to fight what you might call the successor battles around same-sex marriage. I don't think, of course, we've got Obergefell. So anything we could accomplish on the state level against same-sex marriage, it isn't going to happen.
Right.
But there's still all these questions around religious liberty, around parental rights, around anything we can do to push back against that agenda. I think of, you know, right after Roe versus Wade came down, the pro-lifers secured the Hyde Amendment right away. So what happened with us, and by the way, the other thing I want to say about same-sex marriage too, looking back, is how it also circles around back to the judicial usurpation of politics. I mean, everyone, you mentioned all the hullabaloo over that symposium when it came out. All the critics of Father Newhouse and his fellow authors, they all owe those guys an apology because boy, were they prophets. I mean, who could doubt it now that we're no longer, as Lincoln called us, a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. We're no longer a self-governing people. We really and truly are, ruled by our black-robed masters. And so we saw this in Connecticut on the same-sex marriage issue. Connecticut is a very, very liberal, very blue state. It's sort of a petri dish, you know, when for the left, when they have some crazy thing that they want to impose on the rest of the country, a lot of times they'll come to Connecticut first. And if we stop it here in Connecticut, then we're kind of helping the rest of the country because they'll say, boy, if we can't even get this through Connecticut, the rest of the country's not ready for it. Whereas if we fail to stop it, then it's open season on the rest of the country. We've seen this on both battles that we have won and that we have lost. And so for same-sex marriage, was legalized, was first legalized in Massachusetts through the Goodridge ruling.
A court ruling.
So same-sex marriage already existed somewhere when we were fighting it throughout the 2000s in our neighboring state. Excuse me. But Connecticut was targeted not just to pass same-sex marriage, which it had already happened. They were looking for historical firsts that they could put in the history book. They wanted Connecticut to be the first state to legalize same-sex marriage democratically through the state legislature. We stopped them every year for a decade, all the way through the 2000s. Every single year, we stopped them at the state capitol. We had, and this is what got me hired at the Family Institute of Connecticut in the early 2000s. I organized a petition drive against same-sex marriage. I was a district deputy for the Knights of Columbus. The same-sex marriage issue arrived at our state capitol. So what I did was I partnered up the Family Institute of Connecticut with the Knights of Columbus and with the Catholic bishops in Connecticut. And I came up with this idea where, you know, the bishops would write a letter. We'd pick some Sunday, one of the four Sundays in the month of October, where in every parish in Connecticut, the bishops would write a letter that during the homily would be read by the priest about same-sex marriage. And then we'd have the Knights of Columbus stationed in the back with clipboards to take signatures. And that actually helped kick off the Family Institute of Connecticut's database. We gathered about 100,000 signatures to stop same-sex marriage. That was around 2002, 2003. In 2004, we gathered 6,000 people on a freezing cold day in February at the state capitol. These were things that had never been, you know, the view in Connecticut was, well, if we have conservatives at all, they're normal conservatives. They're like small government, low taxes. We don't have any of those icky issues like abortion and homosexuality. We don't get into that in Connecticut. That we accomplished these things, the petition drive and the first giant rally, I think really knocked them back on their feet. And we were able to stop that bill every year, all through the 2000s. So what happened instead was at the end of the decade, our state Supreme Court simply imposed it by judicial fiat. And here we are back at the things that Father Newhouse and his colleagues wrote in First Things in the 90s. I'm seeing it, you know, I was very moved by that. in my 20s, and now here I am in my late 30s, seeing it play out exactly as First Things had predicted. So even then, what we did was we went back to the state capitol the following year, and we secured what at the time was the strongest religious liberty exemptions against same-sex marriage in the entire country. And one of the reasons why we were able to do it was that the two legislators who were the champions of same-sex marriage, and we stopped them every year, they only got it through the courts, but these two openly gay co-chairmen of the Judiciary Committee, after that court ruling came down, it was payback time. They wanted revenge against the church. They tried, at the end of the decade in 2009, they tried to pass a bill that would have stripped Catholic bishops and priests of financial authority over their own parishes in Connecticut.
And I remember that.
Mm-hmm. Unbelievable. Then Bishop William Laurie of Bridgeport, he really led the fight on this. We turned out and of course, Family Institute was part of this. We turned out 4,500 people on very short notice at the state capitol on a Wednesday. And we were able to close that down and then use the momentum from that to secure the religious liberty exemptions that we had been pursuing before Lawler and McDonald tried to do that. So it all, I mean, in the way, in the end, we accomplished whatever we could.
Right.
And even when we lost in a way where we could hold our head pretty high. We've had all our best success, oddly, since we lost that. You know, religious liberty, we've stopped assisted suicide every year for a decade, since 2013. We not just stopped it, but crushed it. They couldn't even get it out of committee. We may be in more trouble this year because they're exploiting the coronavirus.
Right, the fears around that. Yeah, yeah. I want to go back to this episode where the payback was against the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
And Family Institute of Connecticut rode to the rescue, or is part of the coalition that rode to the rescue, because you are a mixture of Catholic and evangelicals. Did your evangelical followers help out with that? Did they think it was weird? Did they see the point of it? How did they react to you asking your whole organization to deal with this issue that seemingly only affected the Catholic Church?
That's a great question. And the answer is the evangelicals were livid.
Yeah, because they saw it. They saw the significance of it. Yeah.
Well, and the some of the the Baptist churches, some of them have a history going back to the Reformation that comes out of resistance to this sort of state control against the church. So even though it was the Catholic Church, I mean, in some ways, the some of our evangelical Protestants had a more clear-eyed view of the threat, I think, than anyone. If you've ever heard of the famous letter that Thomas Jefferson wrote, where he referenced a separation of church and state, and then by the 1940s, the U.S. Supreme Court was misusing that letter. But the original letter was a great statement about keeping the state out of church affairs. Well, Thomas Jefferson wrote that to a group of Baptists in Danbury, Connecticut.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. And I can tell you, the Baptists here in Connecticut never forgot it.
Right. Yeah. So that's an important thing for people to recognize, that one of the things that has shifted as a result of all of these attacks on traditional sexual morality has been that the dividing lines, the religious dividing lines, are no longer between Catholic and Protestant. It's more between the traditional people of all denominations, of all religious branches, allying together against the liberal members and apostate members of their own denomination. So we have more in common with Jim Garlow and with the pastors you mentioned there. We have more in common with them than we do with Father James Martin and similar kinds of people. And so that is a huge historical shift, in my opinion. I just don't think that can be overstated. And I think that is the Lord at work in the background. We had the same experience in Prop 8 in California. That was my formative experience, Peter. 2008, the whole Prop 8 campaign was kicked off in a way by the Catholics of San Diego. Archbishop, then Bishop, Auxiliary Bishop Corleone, gathered together the people with the finances to get it on the ballot. once it was on the ballot, then everybody kind of rallied around. And there was Pastor Jim Garlow got all of the, a whole lot of evangelical churches together. And getting evangelical churches together is no small thing. It's like herding cats, you know, but Jim got that done. And then the Mormons got on board. And so in that experience, in that, you know, summer, fall period of time in 2008, I really felt the Spirit at work, you know, in drawing people together. The old divisions just kind of started to fade away, you know, that it's just, we don't have time for that. Right. Was the attitude. We don't have time for that. We got something else that we got to do that's more important, that's important to everybody.
And it was another instance where, again, Father Newhouse was proved prophetic, you know, because we dropped $62 million into that effort. One, it was a huge Democratic victory that the courts then take away from you a few years later.
Exactly. That's exactly right. It's truly an oligarchy now.
Yeah.
And I think that social conservatives are better positioned to see just how dark the system has really gotten. Whereas your typical fiscal conservative or what do you want to call it, foreign policy conservative, if there is such a thing, you know, other parts of the broad right-wing coalition are not as aware of how much there is a new regime. Whereas we on the front lines of the life and marriage issues, we've been in an oligarchy for a long time.
I'd say social conservatives, I've described us this way for over 10 years. We're the canary in the coal mine. We're the one who said this was coming.
That's exactly right. You know, Peter, we're coming to the end of our time. I'd like to spend a little time talking with people, for you to talk with our people about how people can get involved if they feel a vocation or a calling to state activism. Tell people about some of the things that they can do in Connecticut and at some of your other state policy centers around the country, because I know you'll probably do similar kinds of things. So give people an idea of what's in store for them or what they could potentially get involved with.
So for Connecticut and for the nation as a whole, first for the state of Connecticut, I would say the most important thing you can do is go to our website, go to CT as in Connecticut, go to ctfamily.org and sign up for our email alerts. Even if you follow us on social media or in some other way, God knows I'm a loudmouth every morning on my personal Facebook. But if you are not on our email system, you're missing about 80% of what the Family Institute is doing. And the importance of our email system is it's an early warning system. There's always some emergency at the state capitol or maybe at your local library. There's always something crazy happening in the state of Connecticut, and it happens quick. And they try to put one over on the public so that by the time we organize, it's too late and it's a fait accompli. And so the value of our email system is we can get you that information as quickly as possible. And you can do something about it in your local community, at the state level, or in Washington. So I would say please go to ctfamily.org and sign up for our emails and do follow us on social media. We're listed there as Family Institute of Connecticut Action or FIC Action on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram. And so that's for the state of Connecticut. As for the nation as a whole, I would say this. Google the phrase family policy councils. I believe there's a website. I want to say it's on the Family Research Council's website. They have a page where if there's a picture of the United States of America as a map in all the various states. If you put your cursor over your state, what you will see right away is information on your local family policy council. The thing I would most encourage you to do is find your local family policy council and see if, you know, get their contact info and sign up. Now, if you're in one of the 10 states where, you know, you put your cursor on that at Family Research Council's website and there isn't a, it says, you know, no active FPC in the state, you want to contact an organization called the Family Policy Alliance. That is, it's sort of the link between the FPCs and the mothership focused on the family. It is Family Policy Alliance's job. You can Google them too, to get new FPCs up and running in states that don't have them. We want them in all 50 states eventually, but I cannot emphasize enough that one of the most important things you can do on the state level is to be involved in your FPC or to get one started if you don't have one.
And so then the kind of thing that you'll that will happen is you'll get an email from Peter saying, we need you to send an email to this legislator right now. We need you to make these phone calls right now. We need you to repost, retweet this right now. And so you can have this sense that there's something going on and that you're part of something, right?
Absolutely. I mean, you will become part of a community, of a sort of family of activists that fight these things. You will get to know other people. You can go to their events. If you're in a blue state, you can find out who the few other people are in your state that that you can join allies with. You can organize in your church. I think what, Jenny, I think what you said about, you know, we have more in common sometimes with conservatives and other denominations than we do with the progressives in our own communion is very, very true. And I think one of the most important thing is to get our like-minded people together. And the FCCs are like a clearinghouse for that.
Yeah, that's very important. And you'll find out where there's a march. You'll find out where there's an issue that needs to be dealt with. Peter, what are the issues that you foresee coming up in the next session?
So tomorrow, in less than 24 hours from the time you and I are taping this, the Public Health Committee at our state legislature is going to hold a virtual hearing on a bill. We've defeated this bill for years now, but they keep bringing it back. And I think they want to exploit coronavirus to do it, a bill attacking crisis pregnancy centers, an anti-pregnancy center bill that would basically put pro-abortion politicians in charge of deciding what is acceptable free speech by pro-lifers. You would think that this has already been litigated, shot down by the U.S. Supreme Court, but they have all sorts of angles for why they claim this law wouldn't apply under current court rulings. Whether or not that's true could end up getting tested in court again. But where your help is most, well, the biggest battle that we have coming up right now, the most immediate one, is this fight against the anti-pregnancy center bill. It's really a smear campaign by the pro-abortion lobby. And they're claiming with no evidence whatsoever that these centers deceive women. They have not been able to produce a shred of evidence. All they can do is produce Google searches and what they claim to see in the Google searches, or they send in their own spies into these centers, but there hasn't been a single legitimate complaint. Nevertheless, you know, elections matter and they place their people in our state legislature. So, and this goes back to what you and I have talked about, Jenny, sometimes facts, logic, having the better argument doesn't work, but what we wanna do is overwhelm them. So that's the biggest thing happening. And then the other big thing is assisted suicide is gonna come up again, same committee. You know, you've got a chairman there who treats the committee as sort of his plaything. So those are the two biggest battles.
So, you know, one of the interesting things about the crisis pregnancy center issue is that this really truly is the sexual state at work, because here you have coming up from the people in an organic community-based way, people coming up with solutions to crisis pregnancies that don't involve abortion. And there are a lot of normal people of all ages. It's truly democratic. It's truly inclusive. People trying to help women address these problems. And the abortion regime cannot stand that. Yep. So they have to wipe it out. You know, and it's not enough to just have these two centers side by side, the pregnancy care center and the abortion clinic side by side, and let the people decide. No, that's not enough for them. They have to squash the opposition. And they can only squash the opposition using the power of the state. And this is one of the most dramatic instances of it. And, you know, when you talk about fooling women, tricking women, think about this. Every day of your life, through the whole 9 months of pregnancy, you must reaffirm the desire to carry that baby to term. Every single day, you have to affirm, I'm carrying this baby to term. Whereas if you walk into an abortion clinic in an afternoon, yep, just like that, that baby can be gone. And that's the end of it. They only have to convince you once. Where if the crisis pregnancy people are tricking you, they have to trick you every single day for 9 months. It defies logic to think that anybody could think that those two things are comparable. Peter, what's the easiest way for people to get in touch with you?
Well, I'm on Facebook, Peter Wolfgang. All you got to do is look for this lovely face and friend me on Facebook. I'd love to grow that list. I say a lot of things on my personal Facebook. Most of the posts are not public, but I have like 2,000 friends. So, you know, call that what it is. But I'm also a columnist at The Stream, and I occasionally write for other publications as well.
And people should and can sign up for the Connecticut Family Institute of Connecticut's newsletter list, email list, and you'll know what Peter's doing. Even if you're in California or some other place, you can still be part of what he's doing, at least being informed about it and telling your friends about it. Peter Wolfgang, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
Thank you, Jen.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. Join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.